We will begin almost immediately. Dr. Kumar, welcome, sir. I will not take much of your time. My name is Vijay Srirangan. I'm the Director General of the Bombay Chamber. I just want to say welcome to our chief guest here, and welcome to all of you for taking the time to seek an interaction with our chief guest here. I would like to invite our immediate past president, Mr. Subedar, to say a few words by way of a welcome address. Mr. Subedar.
Morning, everybody. Thank you for being here. It's a very large turnout. We very much appreciate. Honorable Dr. Rajiv Kumar, Vice Chairman, NITI Aayog, esteemed board members of the Bombay Chamber, Dr. Shukla, Chief Economist, Mahindra and Mahindra's, respected invitees, participants, former chairman, former chairmen of the trust, dear participants, ladies and gentlemen, it is indeed my pleasure to welcome you to this talk on enhancing competitiveness of India, Vision 2025. Many thanks to Dr. Kumar for being here. A few words about the chamber. The chamber had its annual general meeting yesterday. It's 182nd annual general meeting. Quite a few years we've been in existence. We believe we do continue in the tradition of our forefathers. We have a couple of firsts to our credit. We have a normal prepared speech which lists out quite a few of them. Most of the people out here have heard it. We were instrumental in introducing the Weight and Measures Act. We had a relationship with BPT, Bombay Port Trust, which continues to this day. I won't bore you with many of them. We continue to engage with government, engage with stakeholders, and I would like to believe in a positive manner, holding up the values of the members which we have here. We have a very large cross-section of industry within our membership, being the oldest operating chamber in the country. In the last decade or so, we've also brought into our fold the entire MSME sector, and we have committees which encourage their participation, reaching out to them, the knowledge which resides in the members of from the larger group of industry is something which we try to spread to the relatively smaller companies. I would like to mention specifically here that the Policy Research and Development Committee of Bombay Chamber has been periodically making representations and organizing seminars and lectures relating to enhancing competitiveness of India for the benefit of our members. Very recently, during the year gone by, we had a conference, India 2025, Enhancing Competitiveness of India, something very similar to what we will be hearing our distinguished speaker telling us about. The participants were Dr. Ratin Roy, Director NIPFP, and Member Prime Minister's Economic Advisory Council, Dr. Ajit Radhande from Aditya Birla Group, Dr. Nishit Desai, senior partner Nishit Desai and Company, Mr. Ashish Kumar Chauhan from the Bombay Stock Exchange, and Sri Viral Acharya, Deputy Governor, Reserve Bank of India. Several other series of lectures which we've had, I don't think I need to bore you with. Of course, we religiously make our pre-budget and post-budget representations. Coming to the subject of competitiveness for 2025 for this country, yesterday at our AGM, we had the keynote speaker in Dr. Fakichan Kohli, the doyen of software, the founder of software in India. I had the pleasure of working in the same organization as him for many, many years. And when I look up the key points in the NITI Aayog agenda, it is doubling farming income. Very interestingly, Dr. Kohli spoke to us about an experiment he and a group of his colleagues conducted a few years ago near Chennai, where he mentioned that the use of technology is ever so important, and according to him, the bane of this country is the agricultural scientists who pass out from university don't go into agriculture. And he even mentioned, I don't think we caught on to what he was saying, he mentioned something to the effect that one should possibly have a stipend paid to these scientists and allow them to work in agriculture and allow them to contribute back to agriculture. He mentioned with some despair the fact that, you know, his experiments proved that he could increase productivity compared to the fields just adjoining where the experiments were carried out by a multiple of the yields which were being produced, and he took it to the government, and I don't think he got a very favorable response. That's what we gathered from him. So that's an area which we just spoke about and heard yesterday, and possibly we could seek more inputs from him and send it to the keynote speaker today. In fact, what he also mentioned is that he had given a speech some years ago at an American university on India has no business to be poor. And I think these are topics which are central to what we are going to speak about. And of course, his greatest passion is that we are not taking computers to the rest of this country. The computerization is restricted to English-speaking audiences. And why are we preventing the rest of the country, about 80% of the population, from enjoying the benefits of computerization? I think those are areas which we need to look into. He obviously gave us examples of France doesn't compute in English, Japan doesn't compute in English, and why are we with a variety of languages not pushing computerization into Indian languages? I know many years back, around the time he stopped being an executive director in Tata Sons, he used to keep prodding us that why is TCS only earning income abroad? Obviously, there was a point of time when the IT industry started, when foreign exchange earnings were very critical for our country. They continue to be. But I think the whole focus was that we are not educating technically our people adequately. We're not providing them the tools of technology which we are teaching the world. I suppose those would be areas which we could look into. Today's lecture on enhancing competitiveness of India Vision 2025 is being delivered by Dr. Rajiv Kumar, Vice Chairman NITI Aayog. Most of you have heard about it, as is normal for an introducer to say that Dr. Kumar needs no introduction and then take half an hour to introduce him. I shall be brief. Dr. Rajiv Kumar has a wide experience of having worked in government, academia, and industry, as well as in multinational institutions. As a founding director of Pele India Foundation, Dr. Kumar was a fellow at CPR and earlier the CEO of India Council for Research on International Economic Relations. He has also been the chief economist at CII and secretary general at FICCI. He was a professor at the Indian Institute of Foreign Trade and serves as the chancellor of the Gokhale Institute of Politics and Economics, Pune. In the government, he was economic advisor with the Department of Economic Affairs, Ministry of Finance, and Bureau of Industrial Costs and Prices, Ministry of Industry. He was the principal economist at the Asian Development Bank, Manila, where he spent 10 years. Prior to his appointment as vice chairman, NITI Aayog, he served on many boards. I shall not hold you back from very soon listening to the keynote speaker. Thank you so much.
That was Mr. Farooq Subedar, who had been with the Tata Group for over three decades and functioned as Chief Operating Officer and Company Secretary for Tata Sons, the principal investment holding company of the Tata Group. His responsibilities included supervising of finance accounts, legal, secretarial, and IPR functions. He was also involved with formulating group policies, advising group companies, etc. He graduated from AHR College of Commerce in Economics with a bachelor's degree in commerce. He's a chartered accountant, having articled with the erstwhile SB Bellemoria and Company. currently part of Deloitte Haskins and Sells, and is a member of the Institute of Company Secretaries of India. He's currently associated with Tata Sons as a senior advisor, working closely with the Tata Group Chairman and the Group CFO. May I use this occasion now to request honorable dignitaries to join Mr. Subedar on the table. Can I request Dr. Kumar to kindly take his... Dr. Prakash Hebalkar, Dr. Sachchidanand Shukla, Sri Vijay Srirangan, I'm here, so no reason to, Dr. Sidhhartha. I am going to request Dr. Prakash Hebalkar to give us a special address, but before that, as is the custom, a couple of lines about Dr. Hebalkar. Dr. Hebalkar served as Senior Vice President of Tata Unisys, has worked with IBM USA, was instrumental in forming and building up the joint venture of Tata and Unisys as a successful software and consultancy activity. He's associated with several leading venture capital organizations and financial institutions, has been an independent director at Blue Star Infotech since January 2000, served as an additional non-executive and independent director at Mahindra Life Space Developers Limited. And he holds a Doctor of Science in Computer Science and Economics from the Massachusetts Institute of Technology, USA. Dr. Hebalkar.
Good morning. You're probably wondering why I'm standing between you and the chief guest whom you've come to listen to. And the reason I'm going to take a few minutes is because I've been after the chamber and especially Vijay for some time now that we used to have something called the think tank in the Bombay chamber that worried about long-term policy and directions, and it sort of withered away. And therefore I was keen to reestablish that, saying that we don't sit in Delhi, so we don't influence the bureaucrats and the ministers, so we need to play a different role, and the think tank was that kind of role, so we should revive it. So that's why we have this group that's looking at research and policy and has the 2025 target in mind. So it's in that direction that I want to take a few minutes to address some of the broad global issues that we ought to factor into policy. We often talk about the bottom of the pyramid and all the things that are wrong with our country and need to be fixed at that level. But as I will bring out, the trends that I'm going to focus on in the global environment need us to focus much higher up the pyramid. So let me start off by talking about three things that I'm going to talk about: consolidation, country borders, and competitiveness. And I'll take 2 or 3 minutes on each of those. Consolidation is something that you might have read about in the newspapers in the context of internet companies like Facebook and their ilk. And that's a very narrow focus, but what it's pointing out is that there has been, as a result of assiduous effort on the part of some companies to dominate the information space, and to then make it a market for the information that they have gathered in the process. But that sort of consolidation takes place in other markets as well. We've seen the kind of thing that happens when monopolies form like OPEC, which suddenly revives after being in some difficulty after the discovery of shale oil and trying to reestablish their consolidation of the market. We've seen it happening in terms of the media and internet convergence, the whole net neutrality debate, which in the US ended about 2 weeks ago when that measure died. And so all the net neutrality arguments have now become academic. And so the merger of media and the internet, and therefore their ability to direct and influence the population, whether it is the merger of AT&T and Time Warner, or it is the merger of News 18 and Reliance Jio, or as many other examples as you wish to bring out. But that's a trend that is a direction that is going to take place in a large part of the economy globally. We see that in the Apple Samsung dominance. We see that in other ways in the Xiaomi dominance of the Indian cellular telephony market. Brands and consolidation are going to play an even greater role in the years to come, going back to the period perhaps in the 50s and 60s where that was a dominant force and we thought it had been largely knocked down. And it's an area that we need to learn from. If Xiaomi can come and in a few years dominate our market, why is it that our brands don't dominate any market overseas? And when they do appear to at least be significant, they're really local brands that we bought over, whether they're a Tetley or a Rexton or a Jaguar or whichever one you want to focus on. Our ability to build brands that dominate or play a very significant market role is something that we have to acquire as a skill, because we will not be able to fight dominance otherwise. The Sri Lankans gave a good example in a small way, but in a narrow sphere. They created the Dilma brand, which represents all the tea estates, and it has a fairly significant role in the tea markets of the world. The Kenyans and the Vietnamese are eating into our commodity market, and they will continue to do that because all our commodity markets are really so cost-driven that they're easily competed against, but I'll come to competition later. The second thing I want to talk about is country borders, and actually the absence of the country border as a force. Our ability to limit what happens within the country borders is being eaten away very rapidly and in many different ways. There was a lot of focus on the cyber influence that the Russians were able to enforce through the mechanisms of the cyber technology in the elections. We've seen cyber interference in banking when the Bangladesh government lost a significant amount of money through misuse of the SWIFT network. We've seen that happening in a different way and soon to come when we see constellations of satellites running the internet in the country. So when you have an internet that is run by a constellation of satellites, where do you interfere? There is nothing within the country that you can interfere with. And so the ability to cross the borders becomes a trivial thing, whether it is running an electronic platform for e-commerce or it is to influence ideas, the country border stops being at all a factor. And that's something that's only going to get worse because we're talking about constellations of several hundred satellites that will cover the whole globe. In a different sort of way, we see it through the trade agreements that are being signed. One of the obnoxious aspects of the TPP, the Trans-Pacific Partnership, was the investor-state dispute resolution model. Those of you who are lawyers would recognize that. But in essence, what it said is that once under that agreement, if you sign onto that agreement, once an investor invests in a country based on certain assumptions about your current policies and the current state of the economy, then anything that invalidates that subsequently can be challenged as being violative of the conditions under which I invested and therefore banned. There was a notorious case involving Australia and Hong Kong that was a case study, and that related to the tobacco trade. A leading company, invested in the cigarette business in Australia. And when a new packaging law came in saying that all cigarette packages must have plain packaging without brands, they challenged that, saying that this under the investor-state dispute resolution agreements of the Australia-Hong Kong agreement, this no longer could be done because it changed the terms under which we invested in Australia. And this can become a very obnoxious thing because it affects public policy. So there are various mechanisms that are, in effect, destroying country borders. And if we don't factor that into our economic policy and look primarily within our borders at our usual drivers of garibi hatao and bottom of the pyramid and all the problems that we face on the employment generation front and so on, and lose track of these other things, we may soon find ourselves hit by a different kind of force that we were not paying any attention to at all. Lastly, I want to come to competition. And we've seen that whole ranking business that we ranked very low on and we've moved up on, and that's something certainly to be complimented. But as we all know, whether it is advertising or it is promotion or public relations, when we talk about our competitiveness, we always pick rivals that we can beat. So when it comes to our universities, we don't look at global universities, we look at Asian universities. And the same thing happens in other things. When states compete, they compete with other states. When you consider that Maharashtra is as big as Thailand, why should Maharashtra not be competing with Thailand for investments? Why are we comparing ourselves with Gujarat or Tamil Nadu? That sort of ability to see beyond, because an investor who's coming to invest in a plant may just as well set it up in Thailand, as Harley Davidson is doing, as he is likely to set it up in Maharashtra. So why are we not competitive with them is a question the state government ought to be asking. So we have to be very careful whom we choose to compete against in terms of trying to meet our own satisfaction, saying we're doing okay, because if we compare ourselves with this lot, we look okay. Well, if you pick the right lot, you look okay against anybody. So in that context, there was an interesting statement made by Peter Navarro, the White House Director of Trade, in which he talked about a militaristic approach to competitiveness. And he said there are six vectors of competitiveness that the Chinese use against the United States. And it's interesting simply because of the analogy that he draws. So he lists the six vectors: physical theft and cyber theft. And we all know about all the intrusions and efforts into the networks of large corporations that we've read about. There is forced technology transfer, which everybody who's gone to China experiences, because in order to participate in the Chinese market, you have to transfer technology. Something we tried very unsuccessfully, and apparently we were not very good at negotiating, but the Chinese succeeded. Evasion of export controls, and that was the latest controversy involving Iran and the export controls on ZTE that were violated in their sales to Iran. Then there was information harvesting campaigns that basically intrude into companies' information, and private as well as proprietary, and steal secrets. Acquisition of crown jewels by state-owned companies. When you have a state, a national or a sovereign fund that invests in companies and takes a board position, they have access to technology. That's a very different approach to technology acquisition from the usual ways of building it or buying it. So this was an interesting model, that competitiveness is also warfare. And just as we have the usual three or possibly a fourth space vector that is now in use in warfare, there are six vectors that the Chinese have deployed in their aim to gain competitiveness in the newer sectors of the economy that they see coming up. Lastly, I want to focus on an opportunity in the area of competitiveness, primarily because I was instrumental in setting up the software export business in the 70s and making it into what it is today. Today, nobody wants to deride it because it's now over $100 billion. But for a long time when we started it, it was easy to deride it. And that came up in focus recently when Korn Ferry did a focus of what the impact of shortage of skills will have on wages. And they did a survey across several countries, and a few of them were highlighted in their report. They talked about Hong Kong, Singapore, and you say, small countries, city states, Australia, Japan, Germany, Netherlands, Brazil, Saudi Arabia, USA, UK. So it's quite a broad spectrum. And what they found was ranging from $8,000 a year to $40,000 a year was the premium that had to be paid for the skills that were in demand. Now, this represents, like the software opportunity that we saw in the 70s, just as much of an opportunity to build a huge business globally and even dominate it as software was, if we are willing to take it. But we have the ability to deride everything under various names: slave trade, labor arbitrage, suit boot ki sarkar, various other ways of saying. Anytime there's an opportunity, we find us saying why it is bad, it is socially bad, we ought not to do it. When in fact, these are the opportunities that are the opportunities of the next couple of decades. And I want to bring that up because when Dr. Kumar keeps talking about policy, I want him to focus on what I call the top second and third deciles of the pyramid. Not the bottom of the pyramid. He'll get enough people talking to him about that. not the top of the pyramid, they do quite well, thank you. But the second and third, which is where our opportunities lie in terms of building excellence. The IITs are no match for Tsinghua. And what we need are the Tsinghuas. So that will come from focusing on the second and third decile, not from the bottom, and certainly not from the top, where they're so busy with their own wealth, they have no time for the nation. So that's what I want to end with. It's the opportunity that we have, and that's what we ought to focus on in terms of our policy direction and not get lost at the bottom of the pyramid. Thank you.
Can I request, or may I request Dr. Rajiv Kumar, our honorable chief guest, to deliver the keynote address?
Thank you very much, Vijay. Good morning, everybody. Dear Mr. Subedar, Mr. Prakash, Hebalkar, Sugato, Roy, Sachchidanand, whom I met really recently. Real pleasure to be here. I've known Bombay Chamber for quite some time. I've visited your very beautiful offices and seen all the photographs, so I know the history, well aware of that. Larry used to be a good friend, and so was Rajiv Lal, so I've been there. I will also address some one seminar there as well, so I know the history, I'm well aware, and I hope I'm not weighed down by it as I speak, and also not weighed down by the challenge Prakash has thrown at me about not to talk either of the top or of the bottom. But so I'll try whatever I can to do this in this regard. Quite frankly, quite honestly, we could have stopped with what Prakash had said and then discussed. But there was enough material there itself for us to chew over. So this is, if my talk comes like a overkill, then excuse me for it. But I hope I can add to what he said. I think it's a wonderful topic to talk about enhancing competitiveness, and because that's where we should focus on. But I don't know why 2025. I hope I didn't suggest the year. If I did, I'm mistaken, because I shouldn't have. Because we normally in the government, which I have now rejoined after many years, I left it in 1995. To go away to the Asian. I was during this wonderful period, 1989, 91 to 95, at the Ministry of Finance, working with Dr. Manmohan Singh. But then I went away, and I've rejoined less than a year ago. We are talking either about the New India 2022 or the Shreshth Bharat 2047. So those are the two visions that we talk about. And the 2022 is something that you will see very soon. We are coming out with a strategy for New India at 75. That document is now with our state chief ministers, which the NITI Aayog has done, and after incorporating their comments, etc., this will be in the public domain, hopefully, in the next few weeks, as it were. So, but that's a strategy because we in NITI Aayog believe that we have to be rather precise and not just make another wish list. Each chapter there, which is no more than 1,200 words or 1,500 words, carries with it the challenges and our approach towards addressing them. So there's an action plan, as it were, in each of the sectors that we're talking about. And that's how it's different from what was produced in that building earlier, which was various versions of five-year plans that had come out earlier. So, but then the other one that we talk about, and we are supposed to do that, and we are going to start working on that, is a vision document for 2047, because that's the year when we have our centenary, and we do want to at least start thinking about what we should be when we are 100 years old as an independent nation. But that is a very big milestone, and will we be able to achieve what we think we should be able to achieve? And if we don't, then what are the consequences of not doing so? And just one glimpse of that, I checked my figure with Shogato as a sitting there, that if currently we are a $6 trillion economy in PPP terms, we're about $2 trillion in nominal terms. But I think we're about six, slightly above maybe actually. But if you are six and you you double every 10 years, which is not very much asked. It's an 8%. And then China has shown that you can average 9.1 over three decades. So, okay, we can't be a China because, you know, we are what we are, but suppose we do even 8, we double in 10 years, then my estimates tell me that we'll be nearly a $48 trillion economy by 2047. And that will make us probably the second or the third largest, biggest economy in the world. And that's the least we should be able to do for ourselves. Because at that level also, we wouldn't be still a high upper middle income country. Because of given our population of about 1.6 billion, that will still leave you at about, you know, in PPP terms, that will still leave you at about $30,000 per capita, or, you know, which is quite high, but in nominal terms, you'll be still about 10, 11, which is what makes you a middle income economy going forward. So, you know, let's not get confused by these numbers, but the fact is that that's the least we should be going for. So I don't know about 2025. In 2022, we can at least be a $4 or $5 trillion economy in nominal terms, and that's what my colleague Suresh Prabhu talks about these days, and that's, I think, something doable. But then, of course, all of this is very good, but then the question is that how do we get there? Can we get there? And Prakash's own things through of consolidation. Country borders and competition, but let me point to you from what I think are 7 or 8 drivers of competitiveness, because that's what we should be focused upon as we go forward. And let me start off by something which I suppose I should start off coming from where I am, which is first is governance, good governance. And I must start off there simply because my belief is that if we in the government can do as well as you people do in the corporate world, there's no way that you can stop India. And India would achieve 48 trillion plus as we go forward. And I'm saying this very conscious of the fact that some people might misunderstand me. It's not as if that the government don't work, et cetera, but the fact is that there is enough gulf gap between the private sector productivity levels and efficiency levels and accountability levels and in the government that if we actually just bridge that gulf, I think we would do a lot for achieving our competitiveness. But here again, I think the way that I look at it is that the summary way of putting it is that can we replace our current state used in political, maybe often Marxist terms, current state, you may define it whichever way you like. Gunnar Myrdal said soft, and there are harsher words that have been used after that, with Ashutosh Bharshini calling it a predatory state, you know, which devours his own children, if you like. We have to replace that with what East Asians call a development state. A development state which looks after its mandate and then does a little more, if you like. And the basic mandates, of course, are, you know, I don't need to repeat them, but at least that the law and order and security should not be privatized, which is what is happening in the country today. You know, so I mean, at least that much. I mean, and that development state then, you know, there is, you know, all the preconditions for capitalist market-based growth is what the government's mandate is. And this is, you know, these are, I mean, I can detail it, but I don't need to. But a development state is a essential condition for India to go forward. And I think that it cannot be emphasized enough. And I think that is something we must keep it in mind, because, you know, very often, why am I saying that? Because, you know, before this government came into office, the feeling had become that the state isn't just up to it. So just junk it. Let's close the state and, you know, lock the door and throw away the key and let everything be done by the private sector. And that was the so-called Washington consensus model. You know, that everything can be privatized from basic education and primary health upwards. And as I said, security. So you get all these jokers in uniforms standing outside your gate pretending that they're offering you security. But they, of course, don't. Because the security has to come with a society which works by law and order, and that's where real security comes from. But you know, that whole model is broke. It's not possible. It's not possible to grow and achieve your goals without a development state in place. And that, I think, ladies and gentlemen, is a critical and minimum condition. And what are the attributes of that development state? Apart from the fact that it provides, it delivers on the mandate that it is supposed to deliver, it has to be an accountable state. So there is a level of accountability that must be there in the state. And wonderful news is that the new digital technology enables you to now enforce that accountability in real time. I mean, yesterday I was at a conference organized by the Ministry of Child and Welfare, Women Welfare, where they're talking about, and I saw it with my own eyes, a real-time dashboard on which the 11 lakh Anganwadis would be able to fill and populate the data on a real-time basis, and which can be then reviewed at six levels of the government. And 1.2 lakhs of them have already been connected to that particular dashboard. So this is the level of accountability that you can actually today ensure using the new technology, and we must make use of that technology. To do that, we in NITI Aayog are doing it. I could detail it through our organization called the Development Monitoring and Evaluation Office, which has a real-time dashboard for all infrastructure ministries in the government, and which are then used, that data is then used for a quarterly review by the Prime Minister himself. So accountability is one. Two is responsiveness, which is that you should, and again, technology can be of a great help here, but any government or any system for that matter, without a feedback loop of accountability and response, I think is an unstable and non-working situation. So that's the other one, that once the government gets a message, whether it's responsive to what it gets or not, I think is the second attribute of this development state. And the third, which is a little unique to us in India, because we are not really a country, we are a continent, with the diversity that we know. Yesterday at another meeting that I was sitting where all the 34 states were represented in NITI Aayog, we had Daman with 1.4 square kilometers to Arunachal, which had 83,000 square kilometers, and then UP and Madhya Pradesh, I'm not even counting because they were there. So that's the sort of complexity that we have. Why am I mentioning to that is that in this country, there has to be something like a democratic competition among states for the state to function. Otherwise, you will not be able to get it. Because that's the only way, and I call it democratic dividend. I don't want to talk about the other dividend that we have tired of hearing. But the democratic dividend is a thing that we must achieve if we want this development, if we want this state to work. And the key here is that for every state that we have, we will have a different model, we will have a different strategy, we will have a different plan of action. A pan-India model of development is just simply nonsense, because we are so many effective geographies and effective political economies that we need to divide. And I think again, your technology and ability so can and then there'll be enough glues. GST is a glue that will keep it all together, and there are others which are coming. So those are the few attributes of that that good governance, which I'd say again, repeat, development state is a critical, essential condition for India to achieve its competitiveness. The second one, and I'm jumping to that I've got here, is something again that we don't talk about at all, I think very often, most often, is the trust between this government and its other stakeholders. At the moment, we actually work at loggerheads with each other. This is always this versus that. There's just zero trust, between different stakeholders. The government doesn't trust the business. The business doesn't trust the government. The civil society thinks that both of us, the corporate and the government, are thieves. We are doing things which are not supposed to be done, etc. There's the civil society, and then the rest, the other stakeholders. If you have also. And some people attribute that to diversity. Oh, we are so diverse, therefore we can't develop. Yes, of course, homogeneous societies like China, 98% Han, can, of course, have a much better, much better chance at it. But nonetheless, I don't think that's the critical thing. The trust, I think, comes because we don't share and we have not attempted to share after our national independence movement a common vision among all of us. You know, I mean, that is the big, because that is the only way to develop that trust. Trust is built upon the basis of some common shared understanding of what our destiny is. And I think here, and this is the third thing, and which is where I break Prakash's rule and talk about the top 10%, but in a different manner, which is, I think the top 10%, which let's call the elite, all of us here, have actually abdicated our responsibility. And that's the third condition also, because we have to accept our responsibility of being the vanguard of society and create, and let me put it negatively first, and stop and cease now finding private solutions to public problems, which is what we've done for the last 60, 70 years. You haven't got bijli, we'll get it our own. We don't have water, we'll do whatever we can do. You know that. We don't have good education systems. It doesn't matter, we have Stanfords of the world, et cetera, or we have Eton and Harrow and so on. This is what this top 10% has done. And this top 10%, until it decides to create a vision for the country, and this was in Marxist terms called, by the way, the bourgeoisie. And the bourgeoisie is supposed to be the vanguard of a society. Unless we decide to create a vision for ourselves, infuse ourselves with it, and infuse this vision among the people of this country, the bottom 10%, I can assure you, ladies and gentlemen, we will never achieve our destiny, we will never achieve competitiveness, and we will not have India as the second or third largest economy in the world, which is what we should have. And we'll continue to be undershooting our potential as we go forward. Because I think this is where, and we often think of it as a rhetoric or as a political slogan, etc. This is where what the Prime Minister says becomes critical. Unless we convert development into a Jan Andolan, unless we convert development into a mass movement, which can only happen if you tell the people that this is what we want to achieve with this development, and this is where we are, and this is how we want to go, and bring everybody into it, and not find our own solutions to lack of development, which is what we have been doing, I doubt if we can achieve the competitiveness that we have been talking about. And I think this is, and I tell you, which is very often what happens, and NITI Aayog found this so much, because I've now visited, I think, 22 states, and I'll visit all before the end of my 1 year. Everybody, all of us are talking simply at each other. We're just not talking with each other. I mean, if you go to, Bihar, the North Bihar, if I go to Meghalaya, or if you meet the people from Mizoram, and you come here to South Mumbai or South Delhi, there is no connection. There is no, so three things. And all of this, by the way, all the three are related. Huh? This is why I mentioned them. Governance, trust, and the role of the elite. That's the third that I'm talking about that we need to get here. Just a very brief example. Because I said this last year to our governors in the governors' conference at the president's house, is that our independence started in 1857, the movement, the national movement, and it continued to remain an elite activity, even despite Congress being formed in 1887, because it was in the clubs here that we held our meetings, etc. It was only in 1942, actually, when Gandhiji said, quit India, that it became a mass movement. And once it became a mass movement, it just took us 5 years. Other circumstances, global, which Prakash keeps, has referred to, also intervened, and they are very important even today. I mean, there is a turbulent world outside, there is all that is going on, but we did achieve that in 5 years. So if we do convert this development into a mass movement and take our Prime Minister's call seriously, I think we'd be able to do we'll be able to do what we want to do with our own destiny, if you like. And the three together is what really is the answer to what Prakash talked about, this warfare that is going on in this world. I mean, there is obviously a world warfare. I mean, you have to compete with each other, whether it is in the fields, football fields, or it's in the markets, and the war for share, markets, etc. We can't win unless all of us, unless India Inc. is a reality. And India Inc. will be a reality when the government, the elite, the corporate world, and the people are all working together and pulling in the same direction. And that is what I think we need to achieve if we want to achieve our competitiveness. The rest, you know, the rest is all very well, and I'll come to them very quickly. But these three, I tell you, are the three, you know, pillars, the three foundations of our competitiveness, which we don't often talk about because we take a very tunnel view of whatever we are doing, and we are just, you know, sort of, you know, confined to our own, you know, sort of, if you like, fields. Having talked about this, the fourth driver of competitiveness is, of course, human resources. You know, and we don't tire about it. We don't tire talking about it. We also don't bother enough to see as to what is happening to those human resources. I don't want to sound very pessimistic, but ladies and gentlemen, we are not in a good shape to derive our democratic dividend. Because, you know, we have whatever millions of engineers and doctors that we produce, that's very good. But our dropout rates on the primary level, our dropout rate secondary level, and the quality of our universities and our, you know, et cetera. I mean, this is a country which is short of doctors and nurses. I mean, literally there is a supply shortage because we are now doing Ayushman Bharat, and we are trying to put together 150,000 health and wellness sector centers in our rural countryside. And lo and behold, you find that there are not enough nurses. I mean, if you look at the ratio of doctors and nurses to 10,000 population in this country, we are way behind the WHO standards. And the Medical Council of India, which we are trying to replace by bringing a new bill, and, you know, because the Medical Council of India had covered itself in all sorts of, you know, inglorious ways, had made sure that there is a supply constraint of specialists and doctors. Because that's how they maximize their rent, if you like. So, but human resources, we need to give much more, and I think the government's attempt at the moment to give, what is it, 1,000 crore for each of the 20 selected institutes, which will be made into institutes of eminence, as it were, and given the complete autonomy, is one serious attempt at creating world-class institutes in this country. You know, because so far, even unfortunately, our best, even the IITs, don't figure, you know, into the top 200 as we go, and neither do the IIM. So we need to have, you know, some people, some of our institutes up there. That's at the top, and I must completely agree with Prakash that that's what's hugely required. You know, that we must build those up, and we must build the quality. But then there is also, Prakash, unfortunately, there's a bottom of the pyramid here in this human resource. 38% of our children are stunted, are undernourished. Their cerebral growth and development doesn't take place that is required to get them to grasp basic concepts and abstract concepts, which is what will be required for having a knowledge economy. You can't have this. You can't live with this. You know, so I think that you need to work at both ends on the human resource. And we are at the moment in NITI Aayog, my topmost priority, I'm also the chairman of the National Nourishment Campaign Mission. And I'm trying to, the fact is that in the last meeting of the National Nourishment Mission Council, National Nourishment Council, there are 7 chief ministers who are members, none attended. And they sent everybody because it's not important enough. And so everybody sent their junior flunkies who attend, et cetera. Yeah, so that's the human resource. The next one, the fifth, is of course an innovative ecosystem. Again, innovation should not be mistaken for jugaad. They are two very different things. I am quite happy with jugaad, but jugaad is a response, is a contingent response to scarcity. If I can't get this, then I'll make do with this. And that make do is very good, but thank you, it's not enough. I mean, that's not innovation. And innovation, this is where I think, again, NITI Aayog, the Prime Minister, under the Prime Minister's leadership direction, has taken a huge step forward in establishing what we call the Atal Innovation Mission. And Atal Innovation Mission has got some of the brightest managers and managing directors. It has also done the big innovation of having the head of Atal Innovation Mission based in NITI Aayog from TCS on 1 rupee salary because we can't afford him, but we give him his car and his room and his house. But he's still on TCS rolls, I think. This is also, why am I mentioning this? Because this is an innovative approach to PPP. We can do this. And there are other 5 managers who have left their jobs in the World Bank and KPMG, et cetera, who are all there. And these young people, boys and girls, I mean, have now put together already 1,200, you know, actually working, tinkering labs in schools in all over the country, in 600 districts of the country. They've already, they are working. And each one of them gets a package of 50 lakhs. There are mentors which have come from IITs, you know, some from abroad. And these Atal Tinkering Labs are 50% in private and public sectors. And 5,000 have been identified. And by the end of March 2019, we'll have 5,000 Tinkering Labs at the school level. And we will have 50 Atal Incubation Centers. Each one of them get about 10 crores from our coffers, then they can arrange own. The idea is to make innovation a way of life in this country, from the child upwards and up to the top, right? So that's, to, I'm saying this is our contribution. Now we should think about how we can multiply this, how we can leverage this, and how we can sort of, you know, expand it further, because that's the only way. And again, I think here again, the trust between the private sector labs and the public sector laboratories and science and technology system, something which the Doyen Professor Mashelkar tried when he was the head of National Chemical Labs and tried to do that, I think, but it's failed. But why should it not work? I mean, so that's something, so that's the fifth, that's the innovation ecosystem. The next one, and I don't want to, you know, but by the way, on the innovation system, I will fail in my duty to, if I don't point out that there is a huge, turbulent, you know, rapidly changing world outside. You know, Industry 4.4 is a reality. Industry, you know, robotics is on, AI is on. This is why NITI Aayog, you've just prepared the country's first national strategy paper on artificial intelligence. It's on our website, please look at it, contribute to it, because we are trying to, you know, bring together. People talked, I think Mr. Subedar talked about Fakir Chand Kohli's lament about why we are not working in multiple languages and only in English. The fact is that we had, so far we didn't have the ability to translate it all, and, you know, given that English is what is understood. But now artificial intelligence makes it possible to, you have natural language, processing capabilities. So that when I was in England recently, along with Sachchidanand there, I met this gentleman, young man, the head of Daily Hunt, you know, which is a news agency, which puts out news items in 10 languages almost simultaneously. So as I was speaking in English, I was being broadcast in Telugu somewhere. So the NELP now gives you that ability for the first, I mean, this is amazing boon for India, that so far, now with our 22 official languages, we can really now get into this. And I think, again, we've just, yesterday or a day before, we approved of a research program in NITI Aayog to create a platform where NELP could be developed, and we've got the professors from Bombay IIT and Delhi IIT to work with us, so that once that is there, then everybody else can, you know, like the UPI, everybody else can develop on it. So, but the point that I wanted to make here was that we cannot be, and it, you know, and we must not be, and especially the second and third decile cannot at all be sort of, you know, dismayed, if you like, at having to make this trade-off between automation and job requirement. We in India have to accept that challenge, because we do need jobs, but we also have to accept and adopt and adapt to the technology and or whatever that's going on. Now that's where the challenge would lie. That's where the challenge would lie, because, you know, how do we do this? How do we go forward? So that's the next one is of course physical infrastructure for competitiveness. We've left it far too long and not developed enough of it. Only 70 years later is our last village being connected with electricity. Shame on us. 40 million households out of the total 250 still without power, which we are trying to connect, and so on. You can't get competitive India with that sort of a situation. But here again, I think a key aspect of all of this, apart from energy and and physical infrastructure, are the two key aspects, I think, are water and connectivity. You know, I think those are the very important aspects. We don't pay enough attention. Please look at this latest compendium that we have come out on a composite water index from NITI Aayog, where we are trying to rank all the states on what they're doing with water. It's a crisis, ladies and gentlemen, that we are faced with. 600 million people living in water stress situation, 75% of our population not getting regular, you know, pipe water in the urban areas. Rural areas is 90%. So, you know, those are in that, that's the physical infrastructure that we must be talking about. I know I'm running out of time, so let me finish very quickly by just bringing to your attention two final things. One is again climate change. It's a structural feature. If we don't pay attention to it, if we keep ourselves in denial, we'll do a disservice. Recently, I believe 4 days ago or last week, there was a conference in Patna, a global conference in Patna on climate impact on eastern part of India, where I believe four amazing things come together. The oceans which rise, the glacial melt which increases, so the rivers get flooded, you know, whatever. The floods which become much more often, and the rainfall which I believe is becoming much less than what it is in the, you know, on a long run average. Eastern India could see a catastrophe before we know we are in it, including Bangladesh, by the way, our neighbors. So climate change is something that we need to foreground. And then the last one that I want to bring to your notice is a great opportunity that we have. And this opportunity is coming from the new forms of mobility, the electric mobility, but zero emission is not the issue. The issue is that the world cannot accept India following the American model of personalized transport in the country. And we at the moment are not there, thankfully. You know, our cars to family ratios are much lower. I forget what it is, but I think it's 18 per 1,000 families, while the American is 786 or something like that. This is a time because the new technology provides us with the answer, completely the answer, to shift from where we are to a situation where we take pride in not owning a car, but in owning a very comfortable ride, as the Scandinavians are discovering. Where we rediscover, and this is to the second and the third elite, let's not think about buying our next Maybach. Let's think of buying ourselves a bicycle and getting our roads in Mumbai worth bicycling, or in Delhi, as it used to be in the 60s when I was a student there. Everybody was, getting them safe and getting them space to walk and to cycle and to have shared mobility, which is what we need, whether it's waterways or railways or public transport. Ladies and gentlemen, that particular, this is a small bit of plug, we have a huge global summit which the Prime Minister himself is leading on global mobility. We are calling it The Move. It's on 7th and 8th of September. Please send us your ideas and suggestions. But the fact remains that this is one bus which we know enough not to miss. But very often we have known of other buses which we have missed because we are experts at it. You know, in the sense that we keep shooting ourselves in the foot. Hopefully, we'll not be able to do this time if the government and you and all of us work together. Thank you very much.